folks. This is your host, Tammy Tuckey, and you are now listening to the Tiara Talk Show. We bring you rare interviews with the makers of Disney magic. Whether they be singers, actors, Imagineers, animators, they have all made their mark on the Disney name. Be sure to check out the show notes, other episodes, contests, our social media pages from Facebook to Twitter, and more on our official website at www.thetiaratalkshow.com. Are you looking to plan and book an upcoming Disney vacation? Contact the Tiara Talk Show's official travel agent, James from Destinations in Florida, by visiting destinationsinflorida.com/Tiara for a free quote. The link is also included in the show notes on our website. All guest opinions are theirs and theirs alone and do not represent the opinions of the Tiara Talk Show or the host. The Tiara Talk Show is not associated with the Disney Company. Thank you for tuning into this week's episode. And from all of us here at the Tiara Talk Show, have a hoop-de-doo day. Hello, listeners. Thank you for tuning in to our 73rd episode in which we are celebrating the second anniversary of the Tiara Talk Show that premiered on August 3rd, 2013. I'm joined by three of our show's past guests to discuss the 1987 Disney animated film favorite, The Brave Little Toaster.
Okay, this is David Newman. I wrote the soundtrack for Brave Little Toaster.
Hi, Jerry Rees here. I directed The Brave Little Toaster, co-wrote The Brave Little Toaster, and storyboarded along with the rest of my team, and did a few miscellaneous frog and squirrel voices, and sang for John Lovitz when he was too busy on Saturday Night Live.
My name's Rebecca Rees, and I worked on The Brave Little Toaster. I had some different hats that I had to take off and on. I was involved with experimental animation. I was an animator, a directing animator, and a story cleanup supervisor, and not all at the same time.
Well, each of you was very busy with your part in the creative team for Brave Little Toaster, and I can tell you several people listening now to this interview are squealing with delight because many of us, including myself, got to see Brave Little Toaster when we were younger on VHS tape. You know, it had a theatrical release, but it was very well known throughout the VHS tapes and laser discs. Oh my goodness, you know, it's so wild to come back and watch this film again and talk about it. I can't even imagine. Jerry and Rebecca, of course, are married, but Jerry, Rebecca, when was the last time you got to speak with David?
Gosh, well, the last time I heard you talk, David, was on the Tiara Talk Show. So I met you here. when did we have dinner together?
No, it's been a while.
Yeah.
We had dinner and had an ocean view.
Because that was one crazy experience, that Brave Little Toaster, that whole thing. I mean, for me, it was just an absolute revelatory experience. I learned so much doing that movie, and it was it's one of the highlights of my life, doing that movie. Working with Jerry and Rebecca and, you know, writing the music and the way it all went together and how weird it was and ending up in Japan and the whole thing. And I know for Jerry it was probably a million times, and Rebecca, a million times more crazy and difficult, but we all loved it so much.
It's funny, Rebecca and I have talked about it, that looking back over our entire career in the industry, that was the most creative freedom that any of us felt. There was, you know, the fact that it was sort of an outcast in a way at the time. It was independent and such a low budget. And, you know, we just all cared about it so much. And Tom Wilhite was so supportive of us in the creative process, and just the distance from the spark of an idea on any given day to it being in the movie was the shortest, least interrupted ever. And it still is kind of startling because so much of it was born with that kind of daily freshness and, you know, without sort of nitpicking.
I remember, Jerry, like, that you would, every few days when you started to get animation instead of, I guess you had done, like, you would send storyboards kind of on video, but every once in a while I would get this beautiful animation, and it would just make the whole thing come to life. And then all the metaphors that you talked about, the toaster with the reflection and the lamp, with the, you know, all the sort of simple metaphors that everyone, all the characters sort of brought to the table, how simple and elegant and profound it was, and then how dark it was at the end, their you know, ride into the abyss, and then their saving. It was all just so, like, for me, coming from my background in classical music and then into film music, it was just such a profound experience and something that was so on the surface simple, but it was such a metaphor for different aspects of life. And of course, not without saying anything specific, it was so profoundly influential from what's come after.
And that takes me back to my first experience on it, and I really appreciated Tom Wilhite's approach to this. You know, I had just, you know, I had worked closely with Tom at the studio, and I was the only feature animator that left those ranks to go work on Tron with Tom Wilhite. And so, you know, we had really developed a rapport. And then I was gone. Brad Bird and I were up north with Rebecca and trying to get the Spirit off the ground. And we were trying to set a whole different course for animation, do things that were not tied down to kiddie films or to always having the same sort of formula. We wanted to get into more bigger cinematic filmmaking. And I'd just been pushing on that for, it was just coming up on 5 years. And Gary Kurtz, who was producing that, was going through some financial difficulties, and that seemed to be running out of steam financially. And so, you know, I let people know that I was going to be back on the LA market and sort of looking for a niche. And Tom got in touch with me immediately. And he said, look, this was going to be at the studio. John Lasseter was the person I had attached as director back then. I had Joe Rampt and Brian McEntee developing with the team. And so that's sort of how it started. But John is gone from the studio, and Willard and I are leaving the studio, and we want to take this property with us, and I'd like you to read the novella where it started, and you can come in and bring a fresh eye to it. He said, you know, I'm not expecting you to do the version that we were doing, because frankly, I was told that it would make a nice short, but a lot of people still don't believe it would make a full feature, would support a full feature-length story. So I'd like you to reread the novella where it started and then go in and take over development. I don't have much money, but I can give you the ability to develop, write, and direct this movie and really make it your own. So I said yes. I read the novella. I went in and had 4 weeks to sit with Joe and Brian. And Tom just really sat back and let me take it from there. So he really let me put my own fingerprints on it then and work with those guys who were so wonderfully creative. But there were major things. Like, I walked in and looked at Brian McEntee's, his sketch of the junkyard, which at that time was going to be in the middle of the movie. It wasn't like the big finale graveyard thing at the end where cars would get crushed and sing Worthless. Like, none of that was even thought of. It was an adventure along the way where they went through and survived a junkyard. And so on my first day, I was like, oh my God, we got to move that to the end of the story. That's the graveyard for appliances. And the owner was an adult and frankly had kind of abandoned them. And so, you know, I was working on how do we make their owner blameless? Well, you make it the kid that they imprinted on and the family moved away. So he's blameless. And having the toaster actually do something brave to save that kid who's grown up, like, all of that stuff was new stuff that I plugged in with Joe and Brian in 4 weeks of doing index cards on the wall. And Tom just supported that whole thing. And the only thing he brought to the table where he said, this is a card I'm laying on the table that you have to keep, and I'm so glad he did, was David Newman and Van Dyke Parks. He said, they're attached, they're on board, you're going to love them. And so that's the only thing that he had prearranged. The rest, he just said, I need somebody to drive this and make it your own. So,
and how long did each of you individually work on this project for how many years? Because an animated film, usually it takes about 2 to 3 years to fully get it completed and released.
18 months for Rebecca and me.
For me, it was just a couple of months. So, but I'm just a post-production.
And Rebecca, which specific characters did you get to animate for this film?
Oh, it was Lampy and Radio. Even though I kind of had my fingers in all the scenes because, at some point during the film, I had to leave a couple of roles and dive into being a cleanup supervisor. So I actually had to work on all the scenes. But right from the beginning, Jerry just said, well, which characters do you like? He told him the radio. And, I could just see in my head how he was going to move. And then Lampy, who could not love Lampy. And he said, okay, they're yours. Go ahead and no one's ever made a lamp move before a radio, so let's see what you can do. And I had never had that freedom before. I mean, before Toaster, I had been in animation for quite a number of years and had gone through 4 years of college. But I always felt like I was struggling. I wasn't happy with my animation or where I was. I just seemed kind of floundering. I didn't know where I was going with it or why I was doing this even. And then suddenly with Toaster, everything made sense. I was using all my knowledge, everything I had learned from art and animation. Suddenly, every little drop I was being able to use there as far as animation and drawing, design, illustration, cleanup, everything, directing the scenes and working with people. It all just came together. And then
experimentation. I mean, I remember you talking and with you and the other people that were doing experimental animation, like, okay, how do you give a lamp hands? And you were so inventive in dealing with a single plug becoming a hand for gestures and all kinds of crazy things.
Oh, that was so much fun. It really was. Especially laying out the scenes, just doing the main poses. And some of the scenes I did myself animated, and some of them I would do the main poses and then work with an animator on completing it. And that was so much fun, just coming up with, like with the radio, with his antenna. How does he use it? The timing of it. And also the radio not having a mouth. I was adamant also that he should not have a mouth. I was really supporting Jerry with that, and I'm so glad because
That was one of the arguments that Tom and I had, good-natured argument. But Tom was really worried that Radio would be the only character that didn't have a mouth and eyes, and I went, well, he's got a face because he's a clock radio, and his speaker is his mouth already. I mean, he's got a way to speak. So at once he saw the test animation that Rebecca and her team were doing, then he was convinced. But something that was really interesting as far as the tone of the film, the warmth of the film, I think it was really critical, and Rebecca can speak to personal experience with this a lot, is, when it was supposed to, quote, go overseas, there was an option laid out in front of me early on where that, there were a number of producers attached to the film, and a couple of them were there just going, send it overseas. Yeah, something will come back. And I went, no, I love this story. We all love these characters. We want to make something we're proud of. We're going with it. 10, 12 of us actually we prepped it for 6 months and then went and lived in Taiwan for 6 months with James Wong and his studio. And we had 3 interpreters full time and hundreds of people working at the studio, and then came back and worked 6 more months here. And just the tone of the film, I think it feels very sort of Americana, but we had a partnership with so many really amazing people in Taiwan. We lived together, and the owner of the studio had said, I will give you a price break if you instruct my people, because I want them to be more capable when you leave and to be sought after by the, the Western animation community. And so tutoring of the people there, and then the classes that Rebecca was talking about teaching people, she had interpreters and taught classes for assistants over there, in addition to doing directing animator work herself. We didn't send it overseas. We went overseas with it and lived with them, and we all made a film together.
And they wanted, all the artists really wanted to learn. I mean, they weren't resisting at all. They worked late on their, you know, and weekends because they wanted to. So, you know, I really could feel that they were very proud of what they were doing. It was just a joy to work with them. It really was.
I don't think there's ever been a behind-the-scenes featurette to this film that I've seen before.
Nope.
And not a lot of information, but a lot of people love learning more about the film. I see Tumblr facts all the time. They post photos and images of, you know, sketches or things from the film that are behind the scenes. I love seeing the recording session behind the scenes photos, because
right.
I think that's so much fun. You have a really big, talented cast coming in to voice these characters. And Jerry, I had no idea that you were John Lovitz's singing voice.
Yes.
Until like 2 days ago when I was listening to the song, and I thought it was him. So I always thought that I got a kick out of that.
Well, it's funny, and David, you talked me into doing that. I was scared out of my mind to do that. I had just gotten into the habit, because what had happened was, which was also pretty crazy, it was good crazy for Lovitz, but it was bad crazy for me, is he got cast in to be on Saturday Night Live, that first season that he was cast, after I had auditioned him and had written the part for him and before we had recorded. And I wasn't quite finished writing the script, because I was writing a few pages ahead of the team. So I'd write a few pages, and then I'd hand those pages out to the storyboard artists, and I was one of the storyboard artists as well. So then I would switch to boarding along with the rest of my team, and then eventually I'd be running out of pages, so I'd run back and write some more pages. So it was during that back and forth process that John got cast. And his agent was just like, oh, he's gone. See you later. And I was like, what? So I called John. I was like, please, you wanted to play like five characters, and I cast you in the movie. I wrote it specifically for you. I tailored it for what you do. Please work with me. So he's like, well, I'll try to work something out. I don't know. So he booked one day, and I got together with Don Ernst, my editor, and we did at Buzzy's recording in Hollywood. We did one marathon session, and the night before I finished writing the script, and had Rebecca read the pages to see if they made sense, and then rushed in and did this one marathon session where John Lovitz recorded everything for the entire feature. And then he was gone, and that got everything recorded, and then he was gone, and he was on the show. And later on, it came time for us to record the songs. And I love ensemble recording with the cast, but John was missing. So I'd always sit in, and I'd do the John voice for any given scene, just to give the rest of the actors something to feed off of. So during the live improv, I'd be there to provide that. So when it came time for the songs, and John could not come back from New York to do that, couldn't join us, I was just going, oh my God, what do we do? And then David goes, what are you talking about? You're going to sing it. You've been doing his voice for months. I was scared. And David, what was that like?
No, it wasn't actually all that much, was it? It was like, it's City of Light he sang in.
And the movie.
Yeah, little parts and everything. But
yeah.
You had it down totally. It was seamless. I don't think anyone would ever even know that it wasn't him. So I don't actually remember that actually having that discussion. I think you were always going to do it, because
there was no
alternative.
I remember you assuring me that Susie Allinson, the voice coach, was going to help me reach the notes and stuff.
Right, because we had a music person. Right. And we did all those songs in like a day or two, I think. It's everything took a day or two.
Hey, David, while we're on here, I'm going to ask you a question that came to me from a fan, about 2 weeks ago. Somebody wrote and was trying to find out who the individual singers were for Worthless. My recollection was Susie brought in a group and then just sort of winged it on the day.
It was a group of session singers. I couldn't even remember the name. I bet there's some way to find out. But remember, Jerry, you had to direct them all. And remember
yeah.
that? That was my first experience with Toaster. because this was way before I wrote the score or anything. This was just recording the songs. And right. We didn't even record everything. We just recorded rhythm tracks. And,
right.
But basically, it was acting. It was getting yes. the singers to act. So you basically had to direct the whole thing.
Right.
And we had a great band. They were great session players. We had great singers. But still, they needed. They were characters. So they
yeah, and I remember her
you're
saying,
"Animate everybody."
Yeah, and I remember her well, who's going to be the race car and who's going to be the hearse and who's going to be, and she'd like try different people and go, "Oh no, you jump in." And,
is it a high voice? Is it a low voice? Is it a rock and roll voice? Is it all that? And then you have to direct what they're going to do. For what you're going to animate in the future, right?
Yeah, and it was so much the adrenaline pump that I think went with so much of the show was we arrived there, and like you said, you've got the studio and you've got the singers, and it's going to happen in a day. So there's not a bunch of fiddling, and you're not going to be back tomorrow or next week or next month, and you try to get the bullseye. It's like fiddling goes away and the bullseye takes over. I have this vivid memory of Susie talking to our blanky voice, Timothy E. Day. And, he looked younger than he was, and he sounded younger than he was. And he was very precocious. He understood everything. But I saw Susie and other people would sort of talk down to him like, "Hi, Timmy, do you know your place on the page?" They'd be sort of kind to him in a very kiddy way. And I have this vivid memory of Susie and some other people looking for where they were. And Timmy goes, "Excuse me, you're on bar 47.
Yeah.
And it's like, and they went, "Oh, thank you, Timmy." And I'm like, no, you don't realize what just happened. He did the adult thing. Don't talk to him. But it was so amusing to watch. And he took it all in stride. And he just, he was amazing. When we were recording the non-singing parts, just the acting role, we all started calling him One Take Timmy because he just was uncanny for understanding the moment. And he really wanted to talk about it. I know it's a cliche when actors say, "Well, what's my motivation?" But he really wanted that. And he would ask me, "What's the blanket doing? What's going to happen next?" Whatever, he would get into it. And I remember the crying scene where he cries at the top of the stairs and people said, "What did you do to that kid? Did you hit him or whatever?" And I said, "No, we had a discussion." And I was talking to him about just being heartbroken, and he tried a rehearsal for me, and I said, "When you cry, I want it to go through the double glass so that the engineer hears you crying and goes through the wall, and the people driving on Melrose hear you crying." And he's like, "Oh, got it." And then we started recording, and he just wailed, and that was like his take one, and so Thurl and the rest of them just started calling him One Take Timmy. And then Deanna, we were done with her for one of the sessions. And I said, "Great, hey, Deanna, see you tomorrow." And she walks out of the recording booth. And then a half hour later, we're still working with the other actors. And I look and I see her face through the window. She's sitting on a bench with the recording engineer just looking in, sipping coffee. And so I went in and I said, "Deanna, what are you doing? You could go home." And she went, "Yeah, but I kind of feel responsible for the group. I'm turning into the toaster." And
for me, Jerry, your description, just what you described, is so profound for somebody to write music to and to be involved in. It's so clear what's going on. Everyone has this sort of place, and then there's a story. And it has a beginning, it has a conflict, and it has some sort of, resolution. Mm-hmm. I can't think of anything as clear and simple as this movie, the way you guys made this movie happen. I was so happy to be...
And I loved how I was amazed how your music made it bloom and just be real and the emotions to be tangible and deep and clear.
I worry that my music made it too big in a way, but I just, it seemed like such a profound sort of metaphor for kind of the way human beings with, using appliances
Yeah, you know, well,
relate to each other.
David Edelstein, I think it was with the Village Voice at the time. He wrote about all of that stuff. When he saw a screening of our film at a festival, he was the only writer who wrote a long review and got into depth about us as human beings feeling like we don't want to be outdated. We don't, you know, issues of abandonment, not wanting to be last year's model, not wanting our warranty to run out, wondering if we're still needed. I mean, he got into all of that stuff and said, it may sound kind of weird to you that I'm saying this about an animated film, but all that, the story levels are there.
And way before anybody else was doing that. I mean, this is like eons before what happened with animation happened.
Well, you know, something else that I think was really, people sort of take it for granted now, but it was very weird at the time, is none of us making the film went, we're going to make this thing for kids. We were making it for ourselves, and we were in our, 20s. And so we were making it for 20-year-olds at the time. That approach and more improvisation is really commonplace now, but at the time,
it wasn't.
And something else that in the animation world was pretty unusual at the time is there were a whole group of us, and, Rebecca and me and Randy Cartwright, he'd had like 10 years of experience, I think, as a Disney feature animator at that point as well. We all kind of looked at each other and went, well, why not put all the emotional depth in something that looks cartoony? Why not? And it doesn't have to suddenly become Bugs Bunny if it looks cartoony. It can have emotional reality and have a cartoony style at the same time. Why not? And so I think that marriage was pretty unique at the time.
And, Jerry, for me, just in post-production, essentially, I just saw it. I saw it live before my eyes. I saw it develop before my eyes. I'd get storyboards, and then I'd get animation, and it would just bloom and sparkle and blossom.
And all the
moments, Jerry, the soft moments, the nightmare, there are all these moments. It's essentially a picaresque story, it's a road story,
Yeah.
And action happens, and then there are all these like quiet moments of reflection where they all, that thing where Lampy tries to understand what is the scene where he's trying to understand.
It's interesting. I did an AMA and Ask Me Anything on Reddit, and that came up. Somebody had asked about that moment, but asked also about the flower, which comes before that. And they were like, oh my God, it broke my heart. The wilting flower. You killed me with that. What was that about? And that led directly to that tent scene. It's like, the night before, they're in the thicket, everybody's kind of, radio's drawn a circle, nobody comes into my space, everybody's sort of separate, and the poor little blankie is the insecurity blankie, and he's going around to try to get a cuddle somewhere, and even Toaster has had it that day and pushes him away. And you wrote that beautiful piece of music when we pan up from Blankie cuddling alone in the dirt, because even Toaster had pushed Blanky away. And then we go up to the next day where they're, they go into the meadow. They finally get out of the thicket into the meadow. I had the Toaster purposely bump into the flower that had exactly the same yellow color as Blanky. It's an innocent like Blanky. It mistakenly thinks that the reflection in Toaster is another flower that it's fallen in love with. And Toaster can't do anything to explain, and when it wilts, it's just seeing this soft, yellow, vulnerable thing wilt, and it can't do anything to rectify it. The next moment, you see Blanky being like dragged down in a hole by these mice, and it reaches over and pulls Blanky to safety and scolds them and protects Blanky. And then that night in the woods, in the tent, Lampy's noticed, like, what's this thing? What's going on? And there's that exploration of why Toaster has warmed up, if you will, to Blanky. And so he equates it to understanding the glow that he felt when the master repaired his bulb for the first time. And those dominoes were, I tried to carefully lay them. So even if you don't directly understand it on an emotional level, the dominoes fall,
And all the care taken with the story, it's all about this. I mean, that's what human beings respond to, and it does pay off. And it's so dark when you get to the junkyard, and it couldn't be more dark the way that right before the end, and even the end, it's saved and everything, but they were so close to annihilation.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's a certain feel about the preciousness of life and all that. I'm not to be hyperbolic, but...
No, but you know what, David? It's
the way the story is constructed is... It's in a way a descent into hell.
Yeah.
And maybe you're right. Maybe it's that we're all going to be used things. We're all going to be used up at some point, you know?
Your warranty runs out, and
yeah,
you know, and it's that somebody treasure you, you know, for what you used to be, and the nostalgia that comes with you, you know, the term you're using, dark. This was really interesting. Deanna and I did a Q&A with a college crowd at Cal State Northridge, and they had, I think it was juniors and seniors, and they had Screen Toaster. And did a Q&A with us afterwards, and it was startling for Deanna and I to hear that word used again and again and again by that crowd, and I've gotten it from fans as well. They use the same word you did. They say dark. They'll go, they would say, it scared the crap out of me. I loved it. And what led you to make such a dark movie? And they would, and Deanna and I would look at each other and go, well, we didn't think of it as dark. We just thought of it as being real to the characters when they're sinking in the quicksand. You know, we didn't do any wink to the audience like, oh, don't worry, they'll be saved. And when Blanky, the Timothy E. Day, did that little performance where Toaster is trying to get him to hang on, and just before he goes under, he looks at her and says, I'm not scared, and with a quivering voice. He's just trying to make her feel better before she dies, you know? And we just went, well, that's what it would be like if you were there. We didn't try to make it extra dark. It was just, that's what it would be.
I think also, when I think about the music, as Toaster falls at the junkyard and gets the gear and saves them, the music doesn't really like... Because I was thinking about this, I think some of that is the fault of the music. It's structured from that to where they're, you know, going off to college, right? Is that where they're going off to?
Yeah.
Right. Nothing resolves in the music. It just sort of ends. There's no like triumphant, like really happy music at the end. It's all kind of, now he's going to college, so that's kind of a death too. The kids.
Well, and the mom is saying goodbye. There's goodbyes happening, and
it's you know, now that you talk about this, it's kind of interesting to think about, because we could have set the music in a different way to be much more upbeat and happy when, you know, Toaster saves the day, but it didn't seem appropriate to the movie.
It wasn't appropriate, and I'll tell you something else. I just loved when you stayed in that unresolved state, and I always loved that you stated, and I thought it summed up the situation in this story and a lot of other stories too, and in life. You were saying that when there's a sort of a happy moment, there's a little bit of sadness in that happiness, because you know it's not forever. As sweet as a moment can be, it is at the same instant it's happening, fleeting, because it'll be a memory soon. And who knows how long? So there's that bittersweet touch, I think, is essential.
David, I remember when we were flying over to Japan, because you were going to be recording the track, and you hadn't finished writing all the music yet.
And you were
behind Jerry and I, you and Chris, and Jerry and I were in front. And I remember hearing your pencil sharpener, your little pencil sharpener, and then you would write something, and then you would say, "Hey, Jerry, how does this sound?"
And
then
you'd put headphones on me,
on Jerry, and then play it. As we flew, you were writing
the whole way, and I wrote 10 hours when I got there too. I didn't understand what I could, how many minutes I could write a day. I just got behind. It was a absolute peak experience for me to do that.
Well, we were all, I think, just doing things instinct. From heart and by instinct, and it worked. And that's, I learned so much on that film that from then on, anything I did, I didn't approach everything so analytical anymore. I really just let my whole being, my heart, just let it go, and that just seemed to work with, you know, from then on, just learning from Toaster that's how I worked, and that's how it worked best, and that's how we got the best results, and so I kept applying that to anything I did, and that seemed to be the magic answer.
And the film is approaching its 30th anniversary in 2017, which is pretty fascinating. I don't think you guys think it's 30 years. I sure don't. And since the film has been released, unfortunately, there have been a few members of the creative team and cast who have passed away.
Yep.
Most notably, Phil Hartman and Joe Ramft. Did you guys have any individual stories, any funny stories about working with them behind the scenes?
Well, I remember, well, somewhere, there's a few people who witnessed this. We were doing other things prior to working on Brave Little Toaster, like with Joe Ramft was in a film that Tim Burton and I co-directed called Luau. It was this silly home movie that whole bunch of animator friends from the time were in. And so Joe played a guy called IQ that was stumbling around in a beach movie. And Joe, in those days, was quite a bit bigger. He got healthier and stronger when he was later, but he was not only tall but quite large at that point. And we were just in different cars, heading somewhere for lunch during that era, and we were up at the top of Barham Boulevard, in about to go across the 101 freeway, and we were at a red light, and I just, it was like improv. It's just, I saw him a couple cars over. There was a lane between us. So he and I start making this, yeah, you want a piece of me kind of thing. And so I opened my door to fake threaten him. And he opened his door and he gets out. And we knew that, of course, the green light was coming. But, you know, I'm, you know, 5'6", and he was 6'5". And so people, you know, at this intersection are watching Giant Joe head towards me like he's going to tear my head off. And me looking at him like, oh, yeah, just try it. And then the light turned green and we like, oh, we ran back to our cars and got in and drove away. So anyway, a few dozen people in L.A. saw improv theater with me and Joe.
And, imagine, you know, the 6'5" Joe in Taiwan. I mean, everybody is, you know, like Jerry and our height. And people would just stare and follow him because he was like a giant. But the whole place was designed, you know, kind of miniature, small doorways, everything was small. And poor Joe was always hitting his head and his forehead on everything. And he'd come in the mornings and he'd have welts on his forehead. And one time he came in and he said he had hit it so hard against, I don't know, something.
I think they had signs lower and stuff too.
Yeah, everything that it... He had a permanent scar right on the top of his head in the middle. And people told me from Pixar, they said that Joe would always, he was very proud of that over the years. And it was like a battle scar. He'd say, ah, you want to feel my scar during Toaster, I got this injury. And he'd always bend down and let people feel like this big knot in the middle of his forehead. And that was from ramming into something in Toaster. And, you know, he didn't bother get stitches or anything. He just kind of let it grow over. But those injuries.
But I remember you were talking about him being considered a giant there. And I remember he felt, it was so sweet. He kind of got his feelings hurt. He felt like people thought he was a freak. And he could tell he felt kind of bad. And we were like, Joe, it's... They admire you. They think it's spectacular. This is, you know, they don't think you're weird. And Phil was just such a treat. He was such a trooper to just try anything. And there was no prima donna aspect to Phil at all. He would come roll up his sleeves and want to work and want to discover and want to make moments happen the best they could. And no sort of ego thing about him at all. And he just, so it made it a complete treat. You never stumbled over any sort of political things or, you know, it was just about being creative together. And it was just a treat. And you know, I'm not sure people realize that he did both the air conditioner and the sort of Peter Lorre hanging lamp.
And Jerry, didn't, someone else, was it Mindy Sterling?
Oh, Judy Toll.
Oh, I'm sorry, Judy Toll, not Mindy Sterling. Toll, right?
Judy and Mindy did the two-faced sewing machine, and right. I believe Judy has passed.
It was sadly. Judy, right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that her Judy Toll's sister, her sister's kid actually went to the same school that our sons did. And we were having a fundraiser at the school, and I had donated a Brave Little Toaster cell. And it was at this auction, this fundraiser, that someone said, oh, there's somebody that wants to meet you here. And I didn't know who it was. And it was, she introduced herself. She was Judy's sister. And when she saw the toaster cell, she just freaked out. She couldn't believe it. And she said, well, I'm her sister. And I said, oh, my gosh, well, you know, my husband and I, we helped create the film. And how is she? And she said that she had passed away a couple years ago from breast cancer. And so I told her, I said, look, if you don't get this cell, don't worry. I will give you others. So I think she ended up being the highest bidder, and she got the cell. And then I got in contact with her and gave her another cell, and had Jerry sign it, and we gave it to her mother. That's a bittersweet story.
Right.
Hey, guys, I have to pop off.
It's been wonderful talking to you, David.
It's great talking to you guys, too.
Yes, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Don't stop. This
hey,
is fascinating.
Dave, let's do another Italian dinner.
Absolutely. All right, see you guys later.
I can't thank you guys enough for coming on the show, and I wanted to add a fun little game. I usually have my Fab 3 questions I ask my guests, but I've already asked them to you guys, so we already know your answers. But I thought we'd do something called a pixie dust lightning round. I wanted to resurrect this idea. Yeah, well, I wanted to resurrect this idea from my old show. Basically, I'll give you two things, and you get to choose what you would rather prefer between the two. So, for instance, if I said Princess Aurora or Cinderella, you would choose which one you'd prefer between the two. And you don't need to give an explanation. We'll have ladies go first, so Rebecca will go first. And then, Jerry, you can just follow suit. There's five of them in total. So we'll go ahead and ask. So here we go. Disneyland or Walt Disney World?
Disneyland.
Yes, Disneyland. I just feel like there's an intimacy to it. You can go in sort of New Orleans Square and in some of those little back alleys and stuff and just completely be lost in that environment and not see anything else. And, you know, no big wide open spaces. It's I just love the intimacy of it.
Captain Jack Sparrow or Captain Hook?
Captain Hook.
I would agree. Hans Conried.
Mm-hmm. It's a Small World or Jungle Cruise?
Jungle Cruise.
It's a Small Jungle Cruise. I would blend them both and you would be going through the song would be going, and they would all be singing in the jungle, and then you would throw yourself in the crocodile's mouth.
I know Captain Hook would not want to do that. Princess Ariel or Princess Snow White?
I think Ariel.
Yeah, I'd go with that.
And finally, Second Star to the Right or When You Wish Upon a Star?
I think When You Wish Upon a Star. That's a hard one, but I'm gonna go with Pinocchio and Jiminy Cricket.
And I'm going to go with Second Star to the Right.
So we have
just,
a balance.
There's just kind of a longing in that appeals to me.
I love it. I have to thank you again for coming on the show. And listeners, I have links below to our previous interviews with, of course, our guests on this show for our anniversary. Thank you, David Newman. Thank you, Jerry and Rebecca Rees, for coming on the show to talk about Brave Little Toaster and also for a fun celebration of our second anniversary of the Tiara Talk Show. Listeners, check out their websites. They're below in the show notes. And I cannot wait to have you guys on again. I hope maybe another special Brave Little Toaster event will happen near in the future, and we'll have you both back on the show, and David too.
All right, we have many stories that are different from those you heard tonight. There's no time for
gonna fight as we travel the land. And I'd be satisfied just to be, not deny, to reside with some pride. What a ride to the city of light.
Hang on to your hats, you devil dogs, because the master blaster of all time is going to give you a soul injection.